I got alcoves like this. Move the punch up to the side a little more. Come this way. Step down. Great. All right, alcoves, alcoves, sopranos. Kind of gather around in this area, kind of semi-circle mic. All right, so step four.
Yeah, I'll go over here.
You're cool. That's a good spot. Let's see. Christy, move these back.
Oh, my God.
Check one, two. Check one, two.
I don't have anything coming out of the monitor yet.
Check one, two.
Give him a hand. Let's give him a hand.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is J.D. Steele, and this is the McPhail Community Youth Choir. Would you please give our future global citizens a big round of applause? Okay, Brad, let me hear that track. More volume, more volume. We're doing some songs from our CD. A little more volume in the monitor, Brad. Here we go.
All right, y'all.
The next song that we're going to do is a song that we want to dedicate to all of you in here and all of everyone outside. This song is called We Need Love, Peace, and Harmony. Okay, Brad. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Northrop. As a courtesy to your fellow patrons, please silence all cell phones and turn off all handhelds, pagers, and electronic devices so as not to distract other audience members. Patrons are asked to remain silent throughout the program and allow the ceremony to continue without interruption. Those who do not abide by this request will be asked by the police to cease any disruptive behavior or leave the theater. As a reminder, the use of cameras, video, recording devices, or flash photography of any kind is strictly prohibited. Thank you and enjoy the program.
Thank you and good evening, everyone. Welcome to the new Northrop and to our Humphrey School of Public Affairs Distinguished Carlson Lecture Series. I'd like to introduce you to members of the Board of Regents who are in attendance, Regent Abdul Omari, Regent Peggy Lucas, and with me here on stage, the Chair of our Board of Regents, Rick Beeson. I'm pleased to welcome our distinguished guest and speaker, Secretary Condoleezza Rice, to our campus and have her relaunch this important Carlson Lecture Series in our beautiful and revitalized Northrop. This is our rejuvenated gathering place for the arts and humanities, for performance and interdisciplinary education. It is a place designed for the staging of all kinds of world culture, for the sharing of life stories from near and far, and for the civil and free exchange of ideas and of opinions. It is a reborn intellectual and artistic crossroads for our Twin Cities campus and indeed for the entire state of Minnesota. We at the university are very thankful for the support and generosity of the Carlson family in so many ways, and especially this very first Carlson lecture from, fittingly, the Carlson family stage. So, again, thank you all for coming, and I'm pleased to introduce the energetic leader of our Humphrey School of Public Affairs, Dean Eric Schwartz.
Many thanks, President Kaler, for your kind words and for your inspired leadership of the University of Minnesota. And many thanks to the Carlson Family Foundation, to Carlson, and to Kurt Carlson, who wanted to establish a series that honored his friend, Hubert Humphrey. I'm convinced that of all the honors that were accorded to Hubert Humphrey, this one would have had particularly special meaning for him. After all, it was our school's namesake who said that, and I quote, "Freedom is hammered out on the anvil of discussion, dissent, and debate," and he meant it. So we are deeply grateful to Kurt Carlson and indeed to the prospect of this lecture, which has stimulated lively conversations in our community, which we welcome. With her appearance today, Dr. Condoleezza Rice joins a distinguished group of Carlson lecturers, a group that includes no less than three other individuals who have served our nation as Secretary of State, Alexander Haig, Colin Powell, and Hillary Rodham Clinton. Dr. Rice is now the Denning Professor in Global Business and the Economy at the Stanford Graduate School of Business. She also serves as the Thomas and Barbara Stevenson Senior Fellow on Public Policy at the Hoover Institution and a Professor of Political Science at Stanford University. From January 2005 through January of 2009, Dr. Rice served as the 66th Secretary of State of the United States, the second woman and first African-American woman to hold that post. Before that, she served as President George W. Bush's assistant to the President for National Security Affairs. And before joining the administration of George W. Bush, Dr. Rice was Stanford University's provost from 1993 to 1999, and before that was on the staff of the National Security Council in another Bush administration, the administration of George H.W. Bush, and served as senior director of Soviet and East European Affairs. Dr. Rice, who has been on the Stanford faculty since 1981, has authored and co-authored numerous books, including No Higher Honor, A Memoir of My Years in Washington, and Extraordinary, Ordinary People, A Memoir of Family. If I may make a personal note, I had the opportunity to work with Dr. Rice for a short time in early 2001, just after the inauguration of President Bush. As you may recall, that presidential transition was truncated due to the dispute about the outcome of the election, and a few of President Clinton's NSC staff members, myself included, were asked by Dr. Rice's deputy, Stephen Hadley, to help in the post-transition period. It was a pleasure for me to work with Dr. Rice on a variety of issues, including the U.S. response to an earthquake that struck India only days after the new administration took office. In Extraordinary, Ordinary People, Dr. Rice writes in a compelling way about growing up in segregated Birmingham, as well as how civil rights issues have impacted her own perspectives and professional life. In this 50th anniversary year of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, we've asked Dr. Rice, as we are asking many others this year, to consider progress achieved and challenges ahead as part of our year-long reflection on civil rights issues, after which we'll have a conversation on the stage. With this in mind, let me also take the opportunity to say that on May 3rd, we will be premiering a new documentary film, Mr. Civil Rights, Thurgood Marshall and the NAACP, and we'll be joined by Marshall biographer Juan Williams and other civil rights figures for that event. And on June 25th, the Humphrey Public Leadership Awards dinner will honor Vernon Jordan, Senator Howard Baker, and many other civil rights leaders for their efforts to promote the objectives of an inclusive society. And so I hope that we're eager for your participation in all of these events. And we are so eager to hear this year's distinguished Carlson Lecturer. So please join me in giving a warm Minnesota welcome to Dr. Condoleezza Rice.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you very much for that very warm welcome. I would like to thank the University of Minnesota. I'd like to thank the Distinguished Carlson Lecture Series, particularly the members of the Carlson family and the Carlson Family Foundation. And it's very nice to see you again, Dean Schwartz, for the invitation to be here with you, to have a conversation about the state of our country, the state of our world, and the state of civil rights. This, some 50 years after the seminal legislation and seminal events that I often think of as a kind of second founding of the United States of America. Let me say first, though, that Dean Schwartz nicely said that I've been at Stanford for over 30 years. You may be wondering why Stanford would have hired an 11-year-old to be a part of the faculty. But indeed, it has been wonderful to be associated with a great university, and it's wonderful to join you here at a great university. We've been through a lot in the last several years. We've been through some very big shocks. We've been through the shock of having the Twin Towers and the Pentagon attacked by stateless terrorists who came from a failed state called Afghanistan and caused the first attack on American soil since the British burned the White House in the War of 1812. We've gone through tremendous economic turmoil out of the crisis of 2008, a crisis that robbed people of that very most important asset, in many cases their homes, robbed people of the ability to work, and many unemployed people who, as we know, if you're long-term unemployed, you will be potentially never employed again. And so we've been through a lot. The international system is still going through a lot as we watch in the rise of nationalism in Asia, in China, in Japan, as we watch in trouble in the streets of Latin America and places like Venezuela, as we worry about the threats of places like Iran and North Korea, and as we watch what is unfolding in the streets of Ukraine, we know that it is indeed a troubled world. It's been through a lot of shocks, and when you have those kinds of shocks, you will have disorder and chaos. But perhaps nothing is more impressive. Nothing is threatening more to unravel many of the old verities about people and the international system than what's going on in the streets and places where people are actually trying to seize their freedoms. Places like the Middle East, where imperfectly, sometimes haltingly, sometimes with great difficulty, we're seeing what happens when freedom is denied too long to people and when they decide that they are going to seize those freedoms. You see, when people are denied their freedoms and they choose to seize them, that is indeed a disruptive and chaotic force of its own. And if you don't believe that, just think about our own history. You know, there's a tendency to say about those people who are working for freedom in places like Egypt and fighting terrible wars in places like Syria, well, they just can't get it right. Maybe they're just not ready for democracy. But the United States of America, perhaps more than any country in the world, ought to be patient with people who are trying to seize their freedoms. I went, when I was Secretary of State, to the National Archives in my last couple of weeks as Secretary. I wanted to see our foundational documents. Now, to be fair, I wanted to go while I was still Secretary of State, because later on I might have had to stand in line. They'll give you a tour when you're Secretary of State. And there I saw our foundational documents, the Emancipation Proclamation for this daughter, this child of descendants of slaves. It was really overwhelming. But I also took a look at our Declaration of Independence. You ever actually read the Declaration of Independence? We all know when in the course of human events. But about a third of the way down, it gets angry and fist-shaking. And it starts saying, you've denied us our rights, and we're going to take our rights, and you think, who were these people? They were revolutionaries. They were people who had to seize their freedoms. And so we need to remember that the seizure of freedoms, the taking of the rights that you and I enjoy, the right to say what you think, to worship as you please, to be free from the knock of the secret police at night, to be free from the arbitrary power of the state, and most importantly, to have the dignity that comes with the fact that those who would govern you have to ask for your consent. That the seizing of those rights is not actually democracy. Democracy is the time, the moment, at which those rights become enshrined and institutionalized in rule of law, in documents, in the political rules of the game. And lest you think that that writing of a constitution is not an incredibly important moment, again, think about our own history. When the Constitution of the United States of America was written, my ancestors were counted as 3/5 of a man in a compromise so that slave-owning and slave and non-slave-holding states could form the United States of America. But it was that same Constitution that Martin Luther King would appeal to in my home state of Alabama when he wanted to say that segregation was wrong. Indeed, he didn't have to say that the United States had to be something else, only that the United States had to be what it said it was. And it would be that same Constitution, the one that once counted my ancestors as 3/5 of a man, it would be that same Constitution to which I would swear allegiance to protect it and to defend it. Those documents are critically important to the stage at which democracy is born, which rights get translated into an actual set of political rules that will define the relationship between those who would govern and those who are governed. And the people of the Middle East and the people of other places are simply now going through that period. But we know something else. We know that even when you've written the political rules of the game, the work of building democracy is not yet done. Indeed, if a democracy is to be stable, it cannot be a democracy in which the rule of the tyranny of the majority is the rule of law. It must be a system that protects the rights of minorities, and that's really hard, as we have learned in our own country, as we had to have a second founding of the civil rights movement to make sure that that was true. Let me take you back for just a moment to what it was like to grow up in Birmingham, Alabama. The child of educators, a father who was an educator, a mother who was an educator, a middle-class upbringing where we had our own French lessons and our own dance lessons and our own piano lessons, and really, life was in many ways quite good in my little middle-class community. But you were very, very certain that you were not a full citizen. You could not go to a restaurant or to a movie theater. I did not have a classmate who was white until we moved to Denver when I was 12 years old in 1967. That was the Birmingham of my youth. And yet, that Birmingham of my youth is now a Birmingham in which the mayor was a classmate of mine in those segregated schools of Alabama. That is how second foundings take place. They take place also when people say, we have had enough. But when they have a framework, like the Constitution, to which to appeal and to which to move progress forward. We know, too, that no democracy is really stable if the strong exploit the weak. Indeed, there is a paradox about the United States of America. We are the most individualistic people on the face of the earth. When we think you violated our rights, we will take you all the way to the Supreme Court, and if we win, we will change our laws. Brown versus the Board of Education. Once had a German friend say to me, you know, the problem with you Americans is you think that because you have rights, you have to exercise them. That would be true. But this, the most individualistic people on the face of the earth, we're also the most communitarian on the face of the earth. We're the most philanthropic. We give of our time and our resources and our money to good causes. We are determined somehow, as de Tocqueville noticed all the way back in 1835, we are determined to collect ourselves into voluntary associations, he called them, to try and do good for one another. Boys and Girls Clubs and Red Cross, Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts of America, Rotary Clubs and Lions Clubs, you name them, they're there. Voluntary associations which try to do good. And in doing so, they affirm an important principle of democracy. That is the principle that individual citizens have to take responsibility for one another. That democracy is not just about rights, it is also about responsibilities. And I've wondered often why, in this most individualistic of countries, with these most individualistic of people, would that premise that we have a responsibility for one another to make sure that there are no weak links in democracy, to make sure that the strong will not exploit the weak, why would that paradox exist here? It relates to another great principle. Americans are not united by ethnicity, by blood, by nationality, or religion. I can go out into this audience, I can meet people who are Korean American, who are Mexican American, who are German American. I can meet people who are Muslim and Catholic and Protestant and Jewish, some who are nothing at all. And yet we're all American. Because to be American is to be a part of an aspiration, a belief that it doesn't matter where you came from, it matters where you're going. That you can come from humble circumstances and do great things. That aspiration has led people to come here from all over the world for generations just to be a part of it. They have come here from the poorest countries in the world to make $5, not 50 cents. And they've come here from well-advanced societies to lead the knowledge-based revolution. People like Sergey Brin, whose parents brought him here when he was 7 years old from Russia, and he founded Google. This country is a country of immigrants because the concept of we the people has been infinitely expandable. It has been able to include, not to exclude, and the inclusion has been only on the basis of the willingness to try hard and work hard and make a new start in the belief that it really doesn't matter where you came from, it matters where you're going. But of course, that ability to mobilize human potential from across the world has also been matched by an ability to mobilize human potential from within the United States across classes. You have not been a prisoner of your circumstances of birth. In fact, your circumstances of birth have been just that, circumstances of birth, not circumstances for life until you die. But the key to that, the key to the belief that it doesn't matter where you came from as a matter of class, has always been a high-quality education. In my family, this is an article of faith. We all have our great heroes. One of ours in my family is my great-grandfather, John Wesley Rice, Sr. When John Wesley Rice, Sr. was a young man growing up in Utah, that would be E-U-T-A-W, I'm not kidding, Alabama, John Wesley Rice, Sr. decided he was going to get book learning in a college. And so he asked, in the parlance of the day, how a colored man could go to college. They told him about Little Stillman College, which was right down the road, about 30 miles, and so he saved up his cotton and he went off to Stillman College to go to college. And he finished his first year, and after his first year they said, so, how are you going to pay for your second year? He said, I'm out of cotton. They said, you're out of luck. But Granddaddy Rice, thinking quickly, said, how are those boys going to college? They said, well, they have what's called a scholarship. And if you wanted to be a Presbyterian minister, then you could have a scholarship too. Granddaddy Rice said, oh, that is exactly what I had in mind. And my family has been college educated and Presbyterian ever since. But John Wesley Rice, Sr. knew that that education was going to transform him into somebody that he could otherwise never have been. And he knew that it would do more. It would transform his whole family. The Rices would forever be on another path. Indeed, his son, my father, would be advanced degreed and eventually end up as the associate vice president of the University of Denver. And my aunt, his daughter, Teresa. Well, she would go to the University of Wisconsin. I know, that's another Big Ten school. Sorry about that. But she would go to the University of Wisconsin. She would get a PhD in Victorian literature, and she would write books on Dickens. You think what I do is weird for a black person? She wrote books on Dickens. John Wesley Rice, Sr. was on to something. Generation after generation now, it really hasn't mattered where he came from. It's mattered where we were going. He died just before I was born. I was born on November 14th. He died on September 14th. My father said that he often said how nice it was going to be to have a little grandchild kind of puttering around. But I have a memory of him that gives me a link to him across the chasm of death. the time of the Great Depression, my grandmother, trying to make ends meet every day, was confronted by her husband, my grandfather, who came home with 9 leather-bound, gold-embossed books. He'd bought them, he explained, on time. They cost $90. He only had to pay $3 a month for a really long time. My grandmother said, "Johnny, take those back. We can't afford it." He refused. And on the day that I received my PhD, my father gave me the surviving 5 leather-bound, gold-embossed books, the works of Shakespeare, the works of Victor Hugo, and so forth. John Wesley Rice, Sr. transformed our lives through the transforming power of education. But today, when I can look at your zip code and I can tell whether you're going to get a good education, can I honestly say it doesn't matter where you came from, it matters where you're going? The K-12 crisis in education is the single greatest national security threat that we face as a country. Because if we do not educate particularly the least of our kids, they will be unemployed. Would you like to try to get a job in this economy when you can't read? And if you can't read by the time you are third grade, you won't read. And they will live on the dole because there will be no place to go but the government dole. And we'll continue to have the case that we have today, which is that only 30% of the people who take the basic skills test to get into the military can pass it. That crisis in K-12 education threatens to undo the work of more than 200 years of trying to make we, the people, a more inclusive concept. K-12 education, an opportunity for high-quality education, is the civil rights issue of our time. It is not that we are any more race blind than we were when I was a little girl growing up in Birmingham, Alabama. But who are we kidding? For those who are educated, for those who have means, for those who have access, race is no longer dispositive. But for those who do not have access, for those who are not educated, for those who are trapped in failing neighborhood schools, the witch's brew that is race and poverty is one that will grind you into the ground. And this modern economy punishes people who do not have skills. And so if I think back on the 50 years of this civil rights struggle, if I think back on the 50 years of the refounding of America from its initial principles to make those principles truer for more of its people, if I think back on the fact that we the people didn't exactly mean me when the founding fathers said it, but I sure took with joy and with honor an allegiance to that same set of documents and those same ideals. When I think back on that 50 years, I say, what is the work that is left to do? The work that is left to do is to make certain that aspiration is not ground out, that aspiration is not disappointed. And that is the responsibility of each and every one of us, to make sure that there are no weak links, because democracy is only as strong as its weakest link. Thank you very much.
Now, is this on? It is on. Very good. Well, thank you very much for that really fascinating presentation. And let me begin by asking what of the role of government? You spoke at the Republican National Convention in 2012, by some statistical accounts, the Republican candidate won about 17% of the votes of communities of color. You have said in your books, you've said publicly that you didn't share all of the perspectives of the administration that you served on issues like affirmative action. So, you know, I guess the question is, what of the role of government, and in the political environment, what do folks in the party of which you're a member need to be doing, not only in terms of the future, but also in terms of an electoral future, if you will?
Well, thank you. Well, first of all, I believe that good politics will follow good policy. So let me start there. And not to put too fine a point on it, you know, the Republican Party can't continue to insult large swaths of the population and hope they don't turn out to vote. I mean, that just doesn't work. And so I'm a proponent, obviously, of the so-called big tent. I share some very strong and important Republican Party views. I'm a believer in limited government. Now, what does that mean? That doesn't mean no government, but it does mean that the federal government shouldn't try to do things that it's, A, not very good at, that the private sector would probably be better at, that we've always prospered with a private sector that is innovative and creative and risk-taking, and that's the real engine of economic growth. It means that we have to recognize that federalism is a strength. Much of the innovation, since we have so much gridlock in Washington these days, much of the innovation is actually taking place in the states. On education, on healthcare, you're seeing a lot happen in the states, and that's only appropriate since California and Minnesota and Alabama may not have the same answers to the problems that they face, and so I'm a believer in federalism. But there are three things that I think the federal government really does have to do. Leave aside, defend the country. That's obviously a federal role. The first is that there are times when the Constitution is being violated in some way. Witness what happened with Lyndon Johnson's and for that matter, Hubert Humphrey's quite successful civil rights legislation that made it possible for my parents and me to go to a restaurant. Right? So sometimes the federal government has to step in. The National Guard was nationalized, or the National Guard, Alabama State National Guard was nationalized to get George Wallace out of the door so that black students could go to the University of Alabama. So sometimes the federal government has to step in. Secondly, the federal government can use the bully pulpit to create an environment in which we're solving our problems. We need immigration reform. We're doing crazy things. I'm training some of the best students at Stanford and sending them back home. Why would we do that? I'm sure you're doing the same here at the University of Minnesota. Immigrants, and by the way, from the low end, who come here to pick crops and the like, all the way to the high end. And on this one, people who say that the 12 million people living in the shadows are a stain on America are absolutely right. We have to deal with those people and deal with them humanely. Then finally, I think when it comes to education, and here I think the Republican Party has the right strategy and the right policy, I'm a great believer in school choice. Now, why am I a believer in school choice? I believe strongly in public schools. But who are we kidding? Right now, we've got an opt-out system. If you are of means, you will move to a district, to a town where the schools are good. That's why houses are expensive in Palo Alto, in Fairfax County, in Virginia. I'm sure there's an equivalent here in Minneapolis. If you're really of means, you will send your kids to private schools. And who's therefore stuck in failing neighborhood schools? Poor kids. And I've worked with a lot of poor parents. Yes, there are some dysfunctional poor parents, but a lot of poor parents just don't have good options. They care about their kids. Every time there's a charter lottery, parents are lined up around the corner to try to be a part of it. And so school choice is a way to make sure that poor parents have the same options that well-to-do Americans have. Because if they don't have those options, then it is the height of inequality. And there, the federal government could do a lot to make that possible.
What about On this particular issue, what about the question of resources for objectives like early childhood education? Is the federal government doing enough?
Well, I think the federal government is best positioned to incent certain kinds of behavior. So whether it's No Child Left Behind or Race to the Top, to try to incent states, for instance, to have reasonable standards. I am, by the way, a supporter of something that's increasingly not very popular, the Common Core. Because I do believe that a kid in Minnesota, a kid in Alabama, a kid in California needs to know, have the same skills. I mean, we're one country. But our problem is that we've been spending more and more and more money on education and getting no results. And so I think these are structural problems, not just resource problems. When it comes to early childhood education, if you can figure a way to deliver it at the state level that's actually effective, then I'm all for it. But most of our efforts to do that have actually not been very effective.
I want to ask one more. I want to ask one more question about an education issue, which is a particular interest in this community, in the university community. The Washington Post wrote a story in 2003, crediting you with playing a key role in helping to shape the administration's policy on affirmative action admissions at the University of Michigan. You made a public statement about that Washington Post report, in part, according to reports, because you apparently felt concerned about that story. Can you elaborate on that? What happened, and what does it say about your perspective on this issue?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, the president asked my views on the University of Michigan affirmative action case that was before the Supreme Court. Yes, I'm black, but I also was provost of Stanford, and so he wanted to know what did I think as a university administrator. I told him that I believed that we still needed affirmative action in college admissions, because if you used the kind of criteria that would that people want to point to, just test scores or just grades or whatever, you would get skewed populations. You would not get diverse populations. There's lots of research out there about why minority kids don't test as well. It's all good research, but I just know that the outcome is you get skewed and not very diverse student bodies. And to me, that's too high a social cost to pay, because diverse student bodies are important to our future, and they're important to the notion that you doesn't matter where you came from, it matters where you're going. If you can go to the University of Minnesota or Stanford, you're on your way up. So that's what I told him. I did not believe in overturning Bakke, which was the question at the time. And I would hope that even if the administration joined the amicus brief on behalf of the plaintiffs in the Michigan case, that we would not ask for the overturning of Bakke. That was my position. Somehow when the Washington Post reported it, I'd suddenly been against affirmative action. And so I went to the president. It was the only time I asked the president to allow me to make a statement contrary to something that he had, that was his policy. And I did. And I said to him, Mr. President, as Stanford's provost, I've stood for affirmative action in college admissions. I can't be quoted as saying that's not the case. And so that's why I reacted so strongly to that story.
If I may, our time is very quickly and too quickly running out. So, and there's an enormous amount of interest in this community beyond domestic civil rights issues to issues of foreign affairs and international relations. So let me ask a couple of questions on those issues. First, what do you regard as your most significant achievement in your service to the George W. Bush administration? And also the issue that you'd most like to revisit. I think when our associate dean hosted a session with students, I think Laura called it a mulligan. If you want to have a mulligan, which would it be? And I think be interested in hearing both, your biggest accomplishment and the issue that you'd like to revisit.
Well, with the caveat that history will decide this, because very often things that look good on that day look pretty bad in retrospect and vice versa. So history will decide this. But I would say that There are really two. One is that we tried to stand for democracy around the world. You know, the United States isn't an NGO, so it doesn't mean that you won't deal with the King of Saudi Arabia just because Saudi Arabia is not a democracy. But we verbally stood for and supported monetarily and with resources people who are fighting for their freedoms. And I think that's important. And I'll tell you something, when I look at Afghanistan, this country that's the fifth poorest country in the world, and I see people lined up around the block to vote, despite threats from the Taliban, despite lousy weather, despite not particularly appealing candidates, I think that we did the right thing in standing for democracy. Secondly, we kept the country safe. And look, I know there were controversial things. You've heard a few controversial things that we were involved in here. I understand that.
We'll get to that.
But the only thing I would say to people is, you know, sometimes it's extremely important to put yourself in the shoes of someone else. And if you were in authority on a position on September 11th, every day after was September 12th. You know, the day that 3,000 people died, with people jumping out of 80-story windows to their deaths rather than be in a collapsing building, the day that I went to the Pentagon and saw the hole that had been blown in it by that plane, we said we would do everything within our power, within our laws, to prevent that from happening again. Now, there are many things I would do differently. I would still take Saddam Hussein out, but I sure would try to rebuild the country differently. We did a miserable job after the initial war of rebuilding that country. The Iraqis, I think, are better off than the Syrians, certainly today, but I would do that differently. And the one thing I would really do differently, it wasn't really our fault, if we could go back to 2007 and get comprehensive immigration reform, I would do it. And when I think that President Bush lost that vote by one vote, it was really a very sad thing. And then if I could just have one final thing. Look, the United States of America has to stand for people's rights, but it also has to be a generous country. We increased foreign assistance to Africa fourfold. We launched the largest public health program in our history, the President's emergency program for AIDS relief. There are people who are alive today in Africa, mothers, children, because the United States of America did that. This country has enormous resources, but also enormous responsibilities, and I hope we don't pull back from them.
Thank you. If I were in the audience, I'd be applauding.
No suggestion there.
I want to ask, we have time really for one question, and I want to pack two or three into this one. And I think it's relevant to the conversation surrounding the lecture, and I think it's important. You have a chapter in your book, and if those of you who haven't read Dr. Rice's book, on her experiences in government, I certainly urge you to do so. The chapter is called Revising the Framework for the War on Terror. And it concludes, toward the end of the chapter, you write, and I quote, "I was pleased that the administration was able to place our detention policies and other counterterrorism tools on a more sustainable footing." So my first question is, what does that mean and why was it important? But you also talk about your efforts to get the government to adopt formally Common Article 3 of the Geneva Conventions, which is a broad formal protection against abuses against non-combatants in time of war. What changes were you seeking to make, and why as Secretary of State and not as National Security Advisor? I think that's enough questions, but they're really sort of all connected.
Well, first of all, you know, when 9/11 attacks happened, we had not had an attack on this territory. We had no mechanisms for internal security. We simply didn't. Everybody else's internal security, interior ministry does basically what the FBI does plus. Ours did Indian reservations and national parks. That just shows you how ill-prepared we were for an attack on our territory. And frankly, we were terrified that there was going to be another attack. Every single day, we were terrified that there was going to be another attack. And so you start to try to put in place what you can to prevent that attack. And information was the long pole in the tent. You don't want to punish a terrorist after an attack has taken place. You want to know what he's going to do and stop him before it happens. And that's the difference between the law, a legal framework, and the war on terror. You're trying to prevent. So in the early stages, we did some things that the President asked if they were legal through the Justice Department. It's, by the way, the same process President Obama has gone through to ask whether the drone strikes are legal. We are a democracy. We have processes. The Attorney General rules on those things. The Congress then can enact laws, which is what I meant by putting this on a more sustainable footing. And then the courts can determine whether or not they are constitutional, these means. That's how we do it in a democracy. When I would go to Europe and the Europeans would talk to me about our treatment of terrorists, I would say, let me say to you, on the day that Osama bin Laden's driver can sue the Secretary of Defense in your country before the Supreme Court and win, Hamdan versus Rumsfeld, then you can tell me about democracy and institutions of human rights, right? So we operate under rule of law. But by 2005, we were in a much better position vis-a-vis al-Qaeda. We had either arrested or killed their field generals, people like Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and Abu Zubaydah. And we were doing better. And at that point, I felt, as Secretary of State, we needed to start to move back, unravel some of the things that we had done in those horrible days of the first attacks. And so I argued that to the President, that we had to do that, and I won some. I didn't win them all, but I'll give you one example. I believed that we had to bring people back from so-called black sites, because I said to the President, the United States of America doesn't disappear people. We have to acknowledge who those people are. I won that. It's well known. Vice President Cheney had the other view, but the President decided to do it. And so you're always in these circumstances. You've got to secure the country, but you want to do it under your values and your laws. And the way that we do it is we have an executive that's always going to be a little bit more security-oriented, a Congress that can pass laws, and a court that can pass on constitutionality. But if it's your last question, I want to just tell you one little story that sort of speaks to what it was like after 9/11. And as with all really dark stories, this one actually has a kind of light ending. After we invaded Afghanistan, if you remember September 11th, September 15th, there was supposed to be an Asia-Pacific Economic Council meeting in Shanghai. Obviously, it was postponed. But we went to Shanghai 3 weeks later, and we'd already invaded Afghanistan. And so every morning, we would have a video conference between the Vice President and Steve Hadley, the Deputy National Security Advisor, Colin Powell, myself, Andy Card, the Chief of Staff, and the President. We were in Shanghai. So one morning, Vice President comes on, and you can just see he's gray. Over the video, you can see it. President says, "What's wrong, Dick?" Vice President says, "Mr. President, the White House detectors have detected botulinum toxin, and we're all going to die because there is no known antidote." President said, "What was that again, Dick?" At this point, Colin Powell says, "What's the exposure time?" Hoping that maybe he wasn't in the White House during the exposure time. But then he learns that, in fact, he was in the White House, so he sits back. The President says to me, "Go ask Hadley what's going on." Now, Steve Hadley is a Midwesterner. He's got a kind of funny sense of humor. I said, "Steve, what's going on?" He said, "It's true, could be a false alarm, but we've sent the samples to the CDC in Atlanta." He said, "Let me put it this way. If the mice are feet down, we're fine. If the mice are feet up, we're toast." So, 24 hours goes by, and we're at lunch with the Chinese, and I get a call, a note that Steve is on the phone. I go, he says, "Good news, the mice are feet down." I go back to the President, who's sitting with Zhang Zemin. I say, "Mr. President, the mice are feet down." They translate this for the Chinese, who at this moment, I think we were speaking in code. Fortunately, we were okay, but it was really scary, and that's the story of 9/11. Really frightening.
Thomas too, so you stay right here.
Well, we'll give our thanks to Dr. Rice in a few minutes. But first, I would like to ask to the podium Trudy Radio, the president and chief executive officer of Carlson.
Thank you, Dean Swartz, and thank you also for leading that engaging conversation. On behalf of Carlson and the Carlson Family Foundation, I so want to thank you, Dr. Rice, for sharing your remarkable story with us here today. Today's conversation is the perfect capstone for the Humphrey School of Public Affairs' year-long theme, Keeping Faith with a Legacy of Justice, a series of civil rights-related issues leading up to the 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Dr. Rice, we are inspired by your story of tenacity and triumph. You have been a trailblazer in breaking down barriers, both race and gender, for more than five decades, duly noted, starting at age 11. The dean noted that you served as the first woman and the first African-American provost of Stanford. He also noted that you were both National Security Advisor and then later U.S. Secretary of State. I would add to that list of trailblazing accomplishments that you have most recently been admitted as one of only two women to the previously all-male Augusta National Golf Club in Georgia. Dr. Rice, what impresses me is your tireless commitment and support to advancing the image of women and girls everywhere. It is unfortunate that women are still fighting for equal treatment to the most privileged of institutions, as well as equal treatment in how we are perceived in comparison to our male counterparts. Thank you. As a former Brownie Scout, I was also pleased recently to see you on the cover of Parade magazine with the CEO of Girl Scouts USA, Anna Marie Chavez, and Facebook COO, Sheryl Sandberg, for a campaign to ban bossy. As someone who has been called bossy from time to time, we both know that for women and young girls, bossy is a negative label that discourages young girls from speaking up. In fact, in a recent Girl Scout study of 8 to 17-year-olds, one-third of the girls said they do not want to be leaders. That means that they will not speak up for fear of being disliked by their peers. Well, I join you, and I call on everyone here to tell our girls, instead, be the boss. Women still represent only 5% of Fortune 500 CEOs, and that number has been stagnant for a decade. So we must all be vigilant in encouraging this next generation of female leaders to speak up and to be the boss. Fortunately for us, Dr. Rice, you were always encouraged to speak up in your family. And while we have yet to see a female president of the United States, I was touched by your story of having been elected president of your family at the age of 4, and how you would call family meetings to make decisions. Of course, being part of a family organization, we appreciate leadership at a young age. So on behalf of Carlson and the Carlson Family Foundation, I want to thank you for continuing to speak up, for blazing trails, and for having courage to continue to do so. Hubert Humphrey was Kirk Carlson's inspiration for this series. Mr. Carlson was deeply influenced by Hubert Humphrey's lectures, including those focused on civil rights, and it served as a lifelong foundation for the friendship between them. As you said, the rights of freedom we enjoy today were seized at one time. The First Amendment right of free speech is a bedrock of the freedoms that this country was founded upon. This guarantees our right to speak our minds and to live our personal truths. And today's discussion, debate, and yes, even some dissent, affirms that those freedoms still ring true today. Please, Dr. Rice, accept this small token, colorful piece of diversity as a symbol of the views that we have shared today.
At the Humphrey School, at the Humphrey School of Public Affairs, in honoring the legacy of our namesake, we seek to train young people to translate social science knowledge into the world of practice. In that sense, as I've told our president, Eric Kahler, who himself is a chemical engineer, we are kind of like a school of engineering. And there's no better lessons for students in such an institution to have interactions with policymakers who are dealing with very challenging trade-offs, difficult decisions. We had a reflection yesterday at the Humphrey School with many other collegiate units on decisions surrounding the Rwandan genocide in 1994. And that event also brought to the fore the question of how policymakers make very challenging judgments in situations of great uncertainty. So we can't thank Dr. Rice enough for joining us today, for providing us with her insights and enhancing our capacity ultimately to train a future generation of public servants to promote the common good in a diverse world. Thank you all. Thank you all so much for joining us. And please join me in welcoming again the McPhail Choir.
Thank you. For weeks, we've been talking about Dr. Condoleezza Rice researching what she's been doing and her history. These are our future global citizens, and I'm especially, thank you, especially proud of these kids. We have a young man here to tell us your name.
Theo Menon.
And what are you planning on doing with your future?
I would like to go into public policy in the area of foreign service.
In the area of foreign service. What year are you?
I'm a junior.
And GPA?
4.75.
What's your name?
Arielle Thibodeau.
What are you going to do?
Pre-law. I'm in pre-law right now.
She's in pre-law right now. Fantastic. Woo! Fantastic. You just went on a black college tour, right? Okay. What's your name?
I'm Tasia Matana. I'm a sophomore.
And since you went on tour, what are your thoughts?
I'm going to be attending Tuskegee University.
Tuskegee University. What's your name?
I'm Shivana.
And what do you want to do?
I want to become a chemist.
A chemist. What grade are you in?
I'm in eighth.
Eighth grade. Wants to become a chemist. Already ahead of the game. What's your name?
Jasmine Steele Dickerson.
And what do you want to do?
I want to be a pop star.
She wants to be a pop star. She can sing, too. Ladies and gentlemen, the McPhail Community Youth Choir. I'm really proud of them. Brad! We're going to do one more song for you. This song is called the highway of hope, because we're all riding on the highway of hope. I'm so proud of these kids. They're going to make a change in our world. They're more connected than we were when we were younger, and I'm just so excited for our future. When you get to work with kids like this, you end up experiencing an eternal optimism. We're in great hands. Please, ladies and gentlemen, the McPhail Community Youth Choir, Highway of Hope.
Thank you. Have a good evening, everybody.